Tell me, say again what you just told me.
What?
that this is the first...
This is the first co-production between Pathé and Gaumont. This is
in the history of cinema.
It's a date in the history of the cinema, yeah. Because it the first, and for the moment, it may be the last, that the only one, it's the only film on which Pathé and Gaumont, which are each of the company are owned by, they are owned by two brothers. They decided that that film was important enough about the history of the French cinema, so they had to co-produce the film, and it's true. There was somebody at Gaumont who was responsible for starting the project. His name is Jérôme Soulet, because I had with my producer Frédéric Bourboulon, we're starting to be. To have lost any kind of hope of having this film financed, when when somebody at Canal Plus told us that they were thinking to make for television a documentary about the French cinema, but they wanted to give it to Martin Scorsese. And I really? Felt very, very insulted, not because Scorsese would not have been good, but I thought I was... not a bad choice, because I knew a little bit the French cinema. And then somebody at Gaumont said that, but this film must be made, because so his name is Jérôme Soulet, and I have to thank him, because he restarted the things. He gave us some hope.
The other day when we were discussing, when we were talking about the film and really where the film begins, where its heart lies with Jacques Becker and
yeah.
your love for his films and how you began your movie-going mm. life with his films, you invoked the fact of decency, of common decency as a value that's always been central to your work and in his films, and you were discussing George Orwell, the writings of Orwell. And
I don't know how many of you are familiar with George Orwell and this expression, common decency, which I think is superb. Orwell wrote some beautiful pages about the meaning of common decency, and he gave a definition which I give in the film. And I thought the terms of common decency was applying very, very, very well to the work of Jacques Becker. It was, I mean, most of his films were about that, about the notion of common decency. I mean, some, you can find other directors. I mean, some of the film of John Ford, like Grapes of Wrath, like How Green Was My Valley, like some films of William Wellman, like The Story of G.I. Joe, and some of the film of the 30, some of the film of Clint Eastwood are about common decency. Something which is mostly forgotten by most of the politicians today, alas, in my country, and maybe in yours. And so for me,
think?
It's important and to find the value in the film. For me, it's important. It's why I wanted to point out the feeling of the collectivity, the feeling of the desire to give without wanting to be given back. The importance of the roots, of the past, the importance, the fact that we had to help each other. I mean, those values that Orwell was finding very often in the working class, less in the bourgeois world, he had found it in Spain when he fought with the anarchists in Barcelona, and he wrote some incredible page, which was so, they are so timely. They are so, I mean, you have to read those lines, those pages, to see how much he talks about today, like everything he wrote. I mean, Orwell is still writing about today. So to find those values in some films, in a few films with Jean Gabin, we found that there was that value in the film of Jean Grémillon, for instance, a director who is, alas, very underrated here and very unknown, at least not as known as he should be. But the same thing in France. I mean, Grémillon did not many films, but four or five films he did absolute masterpieces, and they have in common this notion of common decency.
I just have to say, just as an aside, while we were on our way here, we were asked to sign a Bible.
Yes.
Is that one of the craziest things that's ever
happened? Yeah, a Bible, which somebody has a Bible signed by David Bowie, Muhammad Ali.
Yeah,
and Newt Gingrich. Yeah, you know. I mean that's. Yeah. I mean,
25 years.
I mean, the streets of New York can be bizarre sometimes. I mean, that's the idea of signing between Muhammad Ali and David Bowie already is strange.
Yeah, I mean, and Newt Gingrich.
And Newt Gingrich, but you signed behind Newt Gingrich.
Right, I mean, not by choice. I didn't. Yeah. Anyway. It strikes me that this sense of decency parallels the sense of common effort, and in your film, what you're doing is you're acknowledging everyone who's involved in the creation of a film, mm-hmm. which is different. It's not usual.
It's not because I talk a lot about sometimes the screenwriter or that the production designer or the composers. I am giving less importance to the director. I think it's the opposite. I think by pointing out what some of those people were bringing to the film, and which was accepted by the director. The fact that
he's working with those people and responding to what they're saying.
For instance, let's take the idea of Alexandre Trauner, wonderful man. I mean, he worked on two of my films, Round Midnight and Coup de Torchon, Clean Slate. Great production designer, several Academy Awards. I mean, The Apartment. He's responsible for finding the way the pyramid were closing themselves in Land of the Pharaohs.
Land of the Pharaohs.
He found a system which no scientist, no guy I've ever found. in that crazy film where nothing is true, he invented something which has proven true.
Yeah.
So Alexandre Trauner is working on that masterpiece, Le Jour se lève by Marcel Carné, written by Prévert. And he suddenly, reading a screenplay, he sees that Gabin is living in a room at the first floor. And he thinks, when he understands what is the mood of the film, what is the spirit, what is the theme, that he has to live on the fifth floor. So he's understanding so well the desire of the screenwriters that he's giving an idea which will sharpen that, which will make the theme stronger, and it shows it increases the loneliness of this worker who is trapped in his room. The fact that it explains why he cannot understand some words because he's too far away. Mm-hmm. I mean, it gives, and the director, Marcel Carné, immediately sees what he can do with it. I mean, the kind of shot. It's 10 times more difficult than shooting on the first floor. Shooting on the first floor would be easy. That proved that Carné was not lazy, because shooting on the fifth floor means shooting on a crane, meaning always being on the roof, very difficult position. It demands a lot of work, a lot of that. All the shots are absolutely incredible. So it proves that those people are really working the one with the other, even without, maybe they never explain what I'm explaining now. They felt it. They just felt it. And that kind of spirit which gives to the film something which is absolutely unique, which makes of Le Jour se lève one of the greatest masterpieces in the French cinema. And a film that you can see over and over and all the time being moved and surprised by the acting, by the dialogue, by the way the Carnet is putting a shot which will be immediately inventive after the shot is just finished. I mean, the relationship between the shots, not like now, very little coverage, very little film, a little bit like John Ford. Mm. I mean, the film was shot in 17 days. Mm-hmm. Yeah. 17 days. I mean, so it's not that you cover yourself on all the angles. Everything, I think in the editing room, like for Ford, there is nothing left. Mm-hmm. You cannot cut the scenes in a different way.
Or Hitchcock, or
many directors. I mean, Raoul Walsh, I talked to him, he explained to me how he was shooting, so he was cutting in the camera. Yeah. So you could not cut the film in five or six different ways. Mm. But those people were doing that. Mm. Doing it. Not Renoir. Mm. Renoir, it was more experimenting, and sometimes he needs somebody, but the director of Lonesome, Paul Feijos, did the editing of La Chienne. Mm. Now we have now many testimonies about that Renoir was lost in all the incredible ideas that he had found. Mm-hmm. And Feijos organized them. Mm. Paul Feijos, who's, I hope that everybody has seen Lonesome, which is one of the greatest American silent movie.
Yeah. I think it was a similar situation with the rules of the game. La Règle du jeu and Marguerite, he shot so much footage.
A little as he shot footage, but a little less than that has been said. I mean, mm-hmm. La Règle du jeu, there have been some legends about the film, that the film was an incredible flop. No, it was not a success,
yes.
But it was not a total disaster. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It was said by Renoir, that the film had been hated by most of the critics. Not true. Some very important critic, left-wing, like Pierre Bost, wrote a very, very good review of La Règle du Jeu, and some right-wing, like François Vineuil, Lucien Rebattet, who, in a few years, not in a few years, two or three years after, was going to publish a book about the Jews in the cinema, which is maybe one of the most horrifying, one of the most shameful, one of the most detestable book, loaded with anti-Semitism to a point. I mean, it's not loaded. And it's a book where it says the only solution is to deport every single Jew in the French cinema. Actors, creators, exhibitors, projectionists, technicians, they should be all deported. It was a time where the word deported was meaning something for some people. He said that everybody. He said that the style of Carnet is very Jewish oriented, that Julien Duvivier has a Jewish wife and is the prisoner of the state of mind of Israel. I mean, in the book. He says that Chaplin can be a little saved out of that because he's not entirely Jew. He's not, there is something which is Aryan in him, which prevents him of being completely bad. I mean, you have to read that book to, and he wrote a music dictionary with us about the same thing, which is still published, and in which he points out the Jewish sides of Brahms, the very bad Jewish influence on Brahms, of all the music, I mean, that's, and it's still, it has not been, which in a way, which is good, because the book is very well documented, but it has a lot of anti-Semitic touch in that book that you can still buy now in the French library. By the way, and he was a great friend of François Truffaut. Okay.
I wanted to just ask you about your choice of opening with the quote from Jean-Luc Godard.
It's a quote which he said in Lyon. At the Institut Lumière, we did a tribute to Godard. And in his answer to my presentation, he said that. I did not quote the last part. I did not put the last
the
part
second half of
the second quote. Half of the... Because he said he was opposing me. He says, we are both children of the liberation of the Cinémathèque. He said, which is much better to be the children of Canal Plus and La Fémis.
Yeah.
And he was destroying, because Godard cannot prevent himself from destroying directors. Mm-hmm. So he was attacking Desplechin, Assayas, Pascal Ferrand, which I thought was dumb, was useless, mm-hmm. dumb, was mean. And was untrue. He was making a joke, which can be funny. Mm. I mean, the children of Canal Plus and La Fémis, but it's he's hurting people. I mean, and it's something. I adore Godard. I adore him when I work with him. There's one thing I do not like is the fact that he's using his reputation to attack, destroy, and hurt people, mm-hmm. which I think for me it's not good. It's something that that Eric Rohmer never did, mm-hmm. something that Alain René never did, and something that I have never did, mm-hmm. never done, mm-hmm. Because that was a good example of how you can hurt. People by just with a joke, with a joke. I mean, and the press, the critic, the journalist, they are eager for that kind of thing. Mm. They will forget the context just to quote those words without trying to analyze mm-hmm. them, and they will be like sharks. On that, they will feed from that. The same Godard who said that he also attacked the film critic. He said they are the only one in the world who are less good than the people who talk about sport. Mm-hmm. Because when you talk about sport, you cannot say that a guy run le 100 mètres, 100 yards in 25 seconds. Mm-hmm. you will be out of job if you are saying, giving those such wrong figure. When somebody can talk about a film and misquoting, thinking that the camera doesn't move when it's moving constantly, mixing a pan for a tracking shot, do not understanding and short and reverse shot, they can write that entirely. And contrary to a sport critic who cannot say that the team has won when it has lost. the film critic can say things which are totally wrong mm-hmm. about a film without being fired.
He's got a point.
he has a point. And he also said it's the only profession. They are soldiers which are firing against their own troop. which is an interesting, it's a fun, he can be incredibly funny. I mean, Godard, when he wants to be funny, he can be incredibly funny. So he I remember this quotation, which made me laugh. So.
We'll do one or two questions from the audience. Do you see anyone? Yes, right here. I'll repeat the question for you. Yeah. Yes.
Why don't you stop like in the 1970s?
Yeah.
Why don't you mention more contemporary cinema.
Because I became a film director, and there would be a conflict of interest.
Yes, it's a question about why Bertrand stops around 1970.
I mean, nobody ever wrote that about Martin Scorsese. He stops too when he becomes a film director. I mean, this is normal. I mean, it should be obvious that the notion of conflict of interest, which is not studied in the French school, but it's something which for me is important, and I could not deal with that. And to be a little more serious, I think when you do a film like that, time is important. The distance gives you something. It gives you a wider vision. It allows you to not to be the prisoner of the present. It allows you to forget sometimes, for example, some fights, which 15 years after looks absolutely ridiculous. Ridiculous. I was asked here in this country why I could have talked more about the fight between Cayenne Positive, the same way that there had been a fight between Andrew Saris and Pauline Kael. And I said, but I'm more interested in the fact that some directors had to do in order to get that film going. I mean, I'm more interested because, in the case of a fight between two critics, there is no risk. What can he risk? That to be less invited in dinner because, but a filmmaker could have his career hurt because he fought against censorship, because he fought against a producer. I mean, it happened with Autant Lara when he wanted to sue a producer to get the final cut of his film. During 2 years and a half, nobody called him to make any film. Some directors had their career completely hurt, destroyed. Jean Grémillon, because he was fighting for the union, fighting for the right of the filmmakers, fighting from the film for the fact that the film should be the work of a director and not of the producer. So those fights interest me. The fight between, I said, two journalists, it can be funny at the time. 10 years after, it has no importance. Yep. Now, is important are the films. Mm. And some of the films praised by Saris are still good. Some of the films destroyed by Pauline Kael are good. Mm-hmm. Some which she destroyed are still bad. I mean, but this is less important. The important thing is the fact that the film are surviving those fights.
Yes.
The filmmaker are surviving those fights.
That's right. Unfortunately, we have to wrap it up because we have another show coming and there's a lot more to say, but thank you, Bertrand.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.